October 15th, 2014. I'd like to call this meeting of the Assembly of Delegates to order. We begin with a moment of silence to honor our troops who have died in service to the country. Let's say the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So just for clarity, is there anyone else recording this proceeding? Okay, let's move on to a roll call by the clerk, please. Richard Anderson.
Here.
Cheryl Andrews. Ronald Bergstrom. Leo Kukunis.
Yep.
Nick Hitchcock.
Here.
Christopher Kanega.
Here.
James Killian.
Here.
Marcia King. Teresa Martin.
Here.
Suzanne McAuliffe.
Here.
Deborah McCutcheon.
Here.
John Omen.
Here.
Patrick Princey.
Here.
Anthony Scalise. Julia Taylor.
Here.
Madam Speaker, we have a quorum present with 84.76% of the delegates present, 15.24% absent. Thank you. We'll have to approval of the calendar of business. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay.
Call for the vote.
Call for the favor, sorry.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Approval of the calendar of business. Do I have a motion?
We did that as the journal.
No, I'm sorry, the journal. See, I don't do this often enough to have it done automatically, so you guys look at my notes.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So moved, okay. What do we have here today? We have no members of the commissioners, no.
Public officials?
Oh, are you representing them?
No status report today.
Okay. Communications from public officials? No other public officials standing up to speak? Okay. Communication from members of the public? And I like to keep these very brief.
Fine, very.
It's going to take a while to get to the
3 minutes. Get to the point.
I have bone spurs on my spine, so it may take me longer to stand up than the 3 minutes. Peter County, Yarmouth. I wonder if anybody in this room can answer a question for me. Is this on?
I don't think you know.
Yeah. Is there a green light?
It looks green to me. Oh, push. Here we go. I wonder if anybody in this room can answer a simple question for me. Who hires, reviews the performance of, and dismisses staff at Cape Light Compact? I want one of those jobs. No oversight, no rules, no penalties, no shame, nothing. We now hear that, and I'm going to use a term that can be considered something we don't want to hear in this room, but it's happened so often, I don't think there's any way to describe it other than Maggie Downey lied again. She told a 50% whopper about OPEB funds. Now we hear that not only has CLC lied to all of us about that, there's a $300,000 gap, actuarial correction, they call that. That, by the way, is 100% of the money they did set aside. That's. We now hear that the CLC is considering, or is going to, set up a reserve fund against those obligations. Not give the funds over to the county, who are, after all, their financial agents, and without whom they cannot even have a bank account. Where is this reserve going to be? Is it going to be $100 bills buried under the old jail? How do is an entity which cannot even have its own bank account set aside hundreds of thousands of dollars? And who here and among the August County Commissioners is going to ask that question on the record and demand an answer? This must stop. And it must stop now. We have a rogue entity which actually doesn't exist. CLC is not really an entity. It is, to use their phrase, an aggregation of members. There's no there there. Now we find out they've shorted by 50% against their OPEB obligations, and they don't even intend to make any money available to the county so the county can hold the funds against those obligations, which are the county's obligations, not CLC's. Not Maggie Downey, not Jeff Bernstein, not Shelley McLaughlin. Here is where the obligation must be satisfied. But we won't get any money to do it. How does that happen? How does that happen? And when will it stop? Thank you.
Thank you.
And there's such little things.
The assembly will now convene. Okay, first item is proposed resolution 1402, AmeriCorps budget transfer of $58,920.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. This resolution did not have to come before the Finance Committee, but I can speak to it. It's a proposed resolution to enter agency transfer of $58,920. They're going to decrease line item 001111-5750 by $58,920. It's a miscellaneous matching expenditure grant. And they're going to disperse it among, I think it's 14 different other subtitles within their budget. It's perfunctory. I see no problem with it, and I would ask your support for that.
Motion?
I'll move to approve proposed ordinance 1402 as presented.
Second. Roll call vote, Kathleen? Oh, yes, sorry, discussion.
There are a few members in the audience of people that are possibly going to be running for seats up here, and there are a few delegates here that may not be here next year, including myself. So for that purpose, I would like to, on the record, explain this resolution because you're going to see it again next year. What basically happens really simply is by the time we come around to put the budget together, we've appropriated $58,920 into this specific line item, $5,750, because at that time we are unaware of the exact figures in which it's to be dispersed. So what happens is every year at this time we get this resolution that in fact takes that $58,920 that we have previously approved under one line item, and then now that we know where it's going to go because the budget year is actually in motion, we appropriate that money to this year happens to be, I think, finance. When the chairman of the finance committee said 12, I haven't counted them, but there's quite a few of them this year. So this is kind of, I guess I would use the term customary transfer. And once again, it's for those to remind you, the ones that are here, and hopefully next year someone will be able to explain it to the new members, because there's certainly, I know there's going to be at least one.
Any other comments?
Take a vote. Richard Anderson?
Yes.
Leah Kakunis?
Yes.
Ned Hitchcock?
Yes.
Christopher Kanega?
Yes.
James Killian?
Yes.
Teresa Martin?
Yes.
Suzanne McAuliffe?
Yes.
Deborah McCutcheon?
Yes.
John Omen?
Yes.
Patrick Princey?
Yes.
Julia Taylor?
Yes.
Madam Speaker, proposed resolution 14-02 passes with 84.76% of the delegates voting yes, 15.24% are absent.
Are there any committee reports? No committee reports, we move on to report from the clerk.
Good afternoon, all. I do have a few items to report to you today. First, I want to remind you that we received four proposed ordinances from the Cape Cod Commission, and we will have public hearings scheduled for all four next Wednesday, that's the 22nd of October, here, starting at 4 o'clock. Next item, I want to let returning delegates know that registration has now opened up for the annual conference that's held in Boston every year, and I do have registration forms. If you want to get one of those from me and you'd like to register, I can get this processed before we get too much closer to January. It's coming quickly. Last but not least, I want to let you know that I had the pleasure of seeing Mark Zielinski yesterday. He made a little bit of a surprise visit to the campus, and some of us were called last minute and scurried over there. I'd like to circulate a little picture that we took with him outside of on the steps of the Superior Court building. I'll go this way and then pass it back this way. He wanted me to pass a message along to you. He said thank you very much for the card that you sent him, and he misses the assembly. Just some good greetings, and he looks fantastic. He looks fantastic. So that's it. That's all I have to report today.
While he's going around, I guess we can move on to other business. The one thing on there is request for information from the Inspector General's office. So I was going to ask our clerk to explain that a little bit more.
I was going to try to go over any new people.
Certainly, on a little more serious note, I know that everyone is aware of the correspondence that a lot of, I guess, every community on Cape Cod has received with regards to a request for documentation by the IG's office related to the report conducted by the Special Committee on Inquiry into Cape Life Compact and CBEC. It's my understanding that I think the commissioners got a letter, and anybody that maybe had any association with anything to do with this report. And I guess I'm happy to say that our section, or our piece, our documentation has been completed. I didn't think I was going to be able to do it on time, but I did. I can tell you that it consumed 12 reams of paper. I literally stood 18 hours in front of the copy machine, because that's how it had to be done. And I think they've got every scrap of paper. And if they don't, all they need to do is just say, hey, this is what we're missing, and I'll go digging. But literally, it was a huge undertaking to get that all done in terms of a little bit of research and literally just producing the documents to get them to the IG's office. So they have them, and I just wanted to convey that to you. You received a copy of the letter that we received requesting that information, and you can see we received it on October 7th, and the request was to comply by the 17th. Given that I had a scheduled day off and there was a holiday in there, I was just like beside myself. They did grant us an extension. I asked and received a small extension of a week, but as it turned out, I didn't end up needing that. So we were able to comply and get them the documents. And that's it. That's all I have to report on that.
I'm glad to hear we're in compliance and that's taken care of. Any other items under other business? Yeah.
I have a proposed ordinance I'd like to file. The delegate from Barnstable and I have worked on this and prepared it so we could file it today. Just to give you a little bit of background on it, I won't speak for him, but I will say in the discussions that he and I had, both of us were taken back by the fact that the last year's budget has, when we got the reconciliation for it, it was quite evident that we had a quite large shortfall in the proposed revenue side of it, and really were not made aware of that until months after the new budget season started. So the gist of this this proposed ordinance, basically, and I won't read it in its entirety because I'll file it and you'll all get copies of it, but it's basically to kind of put in place a procedure in which after a budget is passed, that if in fact there is a perceived shortfall in any projected revenues coming in, that an ordinance is going to have to be placed in front of the assembly asking for a transfer of funds from a specific either savings account or reserve fund to be transferred into the budget to make up that shortfall. And I believe also there is language in here, and our belief is that it will also give the opportunity of the Assembly of Delegates to make a decision at that time whether they want to in fact do that, transfer money into the budget from the savings account, or if they want to mid-year make a proposal to actually cut the budget so that they can meet the budget requirements. So with that said, I would like to hand that in. I don't know if my partner in crime wants to add to that. But.
No, it was well stated, and again, we'll get into more discussions later on, but what this is also going in along with the fact that it'll also open up better communications between both branches and give us a little bit more oversight over the budgetary matters. We'll talk more hopefully next week.
Suzanne?
Yes, just a question. So is this for transfer from reserve accounts or other accounts, or is it a transfer, for, any transfer, let's say you're going to transfer from one account to another to cover a shortfall, it's just, but it's mostly just for the reserves?
If I may, Madam Speaker. Presently we have in the works our procedures that we use, that when we're transferring money from salary and wages to expenses, that has to be done through an ordinance. And if we're transferring from one department to another, we have done that. People have come in and said, well, we're not gonna use this money and you can switch it over that way. This really is targeting or adding to that list the ability for our chief financial officer to supplement the budget with a transfer of money from savings, which obviously must have been done because we had a shortfall of over $800,000 last year and we were not aware of it. So I believe that this pretty much just targets that exchange.
Suzanne, it seems to me that if we're operating by ordinance, it's kind of patchwork. And I know, you know, most municipalities have some pretty regulated procedures about how they handle budget transfers and shortfalls, and whether you know, whether we get specific updates. But it seems to me that might be something we could specifically ask the DOR for assistance with. I know they declined, but they have helped Dukes County. So that might be a specific request in terms of getting some financial regulations that aren't just necessarily ordinance by ordinance. I do support this ordinance, and the
short term, not supporting or not supporting it right now, but we're kind of starting to move into the gray area of discussion, which we're going to have ample time for when it comes to course. Clarification is okay, but we're kind of moving in that gray area.
Okay, but I just would say that I'll make a comment then that with the financial practices are appearing to come through the ordinance. Is that just a comment?
Thank you. Anything else under new business? Another business? Jim?
Yeah, we still have a resolution on the table in the Finance Committee regarding special counsel, and I'd like to meet again to resolve that. Now, I had given some information to the Speaker because the question came up about the cost of what we're going to be doing, and I gave him some parameters so that he could obtain those costs. So I would like to try and get this on the agenda or on the back to the Finance Committee at our next meeting. But what is the cutoff date for that notice?
Clark?
Well, it's tabled until you resurrect it again.
We can bring it back anytime.
Yes, correct. Just keep in mind that it's, the government regs is meeting next week, and with this proposed ordinance, I believe it's going to finance. So finance will be meeting on the 5th of November for this purpose, and
So we can.
Talking to, you know, you have to have some conversation with the chair, finance chair, and we'll look at time and scheduling. Just want to make sure we have, you know, adequate time. You may have to come in a little bit earlier than 3 in order to address both of these, and maybe not, I don't know, we're going to have that conversation.
If the member from Sam would like us to do that, bring that back up again, and says, well, I'd be happy to do that. Can you contact the members of the finance committee that are not here to find out if we can get it warm at 2 o'clock? I think an hour is plenty for that.
Well,
3 o'clock's going to be the other, the first.
Yeah, you're going to deal with the one that Leo submitted today. I don't know how long that will take, but that's why I think I got to have some discussion with John and to try to make sure that, you know, we're not allowing too much time because I know people have commitments, but we have enough time to deal with both on that day.
I hate to feel rushed.
I might be retired after the November 5th.
All right, anything else under other business?
Somebody's got to do what she's in
this chair. Somebody's got to do what I'm usually doing?
Oh, move to adjourn.
Second.
All right, you're adjourned. Oh, good, well, yes. Oh, all in favor of adjourned?
Aye.